U.S. Senator Jeff Merkley.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mayor. Well, thank you very much, Mayor, for the introduction, and thank you to the Alliance for organizing this set of meetings to help address issues related to housing. As the Mayor indicated, this is an issue very near and dear to my heart. And it plays such a critical role, housing does, in the success of our families. Back in 1967, Congress decided to do a resolution to say how important that was. And that resolution said, "The goal of a decent home and a suitable living environment for every family will be the goal of the United States of America." And it went on to say that the reason is because such housing is necessary for the general welfare and security of our nation. Well, certainly everyone in this room is intimately familiar with the issue of housing, having grown up with one in one, having wrestled with what type of a home to provide to your own family, and to have seen the circumstances here in the metropolitan area. The connection for me starts with the fact that my father, a mechanic, was able, along with my mother, but only my dad was working, to be able to buy a three-bedroom ranch house when they came to Portland, and that served as the foundation of our family's stability and also economic security. Being able to buy a home is a key piece of the building of middle-class wealth. But even apart from that, it's a big part of the stability in which children find themselves. Whether you are, if I go back before my chapter of life and serving at Human Solutions, I was at Habitat for Humanity starting in 1991 to 1994. And at Habitat, I was working with families that had been homeless. And they had been living in vans, and they had been living in basements, and they'd been moving from relative's couch to friend's couch to someone else's spare bedroom, shifting schools all the time, not having a place to do their homework, not having a location they could invite friends over. I remember this one family, two daughters, and after they gained their own home, and Habitat has this sweat equity model, so the whole family worked very hard to put in their 400 to 500 hours as part of becoming a homeowner. But for the first time in their life, they were able to invite friends over. And they talked to their mother about how incredibly important this was to them, how incredibly proud they were of that opportunity. And I remember another family that had always lived in apartments when they had a home and had never done a home repair. And called me up and said, "Well, we've got this problem. The neighborhood kids were swinging on our front gate and the hinges tore out. And what do we do?" And, "Well, come on down and I'll show you how put a screwdriver to work, put those screws back in." And he's a little bit of pause. "Well, you can't come down and do it for me?" And, "Nope." And then another family said, "You know, we've always wanted to have a place that we could paint. That whatever color we wanted, like it's ours, like it belongs to us." And I said, "Well, that's great. What color do you have in mind?" And he said, "We're going to paint it purple." And they did. And I'm sure their neighbors found that a surprising and interesting color. But the fact is that the stability of affordable housing, I was thinking about that 1967 resolution because the words were very similar to Habitat for Humanity's motto, a decent home and a decent community for every family. I mean, shouldn't we be able to achieve that? Shouldn't we be able to achieve that as a developed nation? And the fact is we're far from it, and we're getting further from it. The country faces a massive shortage of affordable housing. We have, if you look at just the segment of society that is defined as extremely low-income households, there are 11.4 million families in that household. Of that group, you have essentially housing for about 4 million that is affordable. So the other three quarters are renting in households where they spend more than 50% of their income. So if you take a very low-income family, they have modest, very modest income to begin with, and more than half of it is going to housing. Very little is left for everything else. So that is very challenging. And now, here in the metropolitan area, we have an extremely low vacancy rate. And rents have been going up. Rents have been going up so much that individuals who finally get to the top of the waiting list for a housing voucher, which helps pay the share of their rent that is over 30% of their income, well, they go out and they can't find a place to rent because there's nothing affordable, there's nothing available in that affordability range. And we've had both folks with regular vouchers, and we've had veterans with vouchers unable to actually secure a place to live. And fact, rents in this metropolitan area up 30% since 2012. That's a huge increase. And nationally, we are fourth in the nation for housing price increases. And another way of looking at it is we are the third most unaffordable rental market in the United States. Well, the problem is not getting better, because people across the nation are hearing how wonderful it is to live in the Portland metropolitan area, the three-county area. U-Haul had statistics on which were the locations that were the primary destinations for one-way truck rental and trailer rental. And we're no longer the top, I was told. I haven't looked it up myself. But for several years, we were the top destination in the country. And there's reasons people want to come here, because we are a spectacular place to live. But our housing supply hasn't kept pace. So we were hoping to have the administration advocate to really dedicate resources to assisting communities in taking on this problem, this challenge. And we didn't get that yet. The budget, now that we had the skinny budget, that is the broad outlines of a budget submitted by President Trump's team, and now we have the detailed budget. And I have a page of all those housing-related programs and what happened to them in the president's budget. But just to summarize programs that were eliminated: self-help homeownership opportunity program, community development block grants, a powerful tool for communities to address a variety of issues, and that often includes housing. When I was developing tax credit projects for Human Solutions, so these are the multiplexes in which you apply to the state, and the state distributes these tax credits that you then sell to a syndicator and raises funds to subsidize the cost. It's one of the major ways of funding multifamily housing. When I was immersed in doing that, one of the accompanying sources of income that I applied to through Multnomah County was CDBG. And then you have, in addition to CDBG, which can be used more flexibly, community development block grants, you have the home investment partnership programs, the home grants. And the home grants, these are all zeroed out, by the way. These are not cuts. These are programs that were zeroed out. Choice Neighborhoods Initiative, zeroed out. Housing Trust Fund donations, zeroed out. Capital Magnet Fund, zeroed out. Community Development Funds, zeroed out. Vouchers for Veterans, which I have gone to bat to get more veterans vouchers nationally and to get to help organize groups here to apply for them and use them. This program, zeroed out. And we see here the enormous challenge because we see people living on the street, and we see the growth in that. To come back into the metro area and see tents on clover leaves and underpasses, it's pretty shocking. I think if you were in a time capsule and you visited the area 10 or 15 years ago and you visited now, you'd go, what is going on? And yet here we are with the economy at a fairly vigorous point in time. We're not in the middle of a Great Depression. We are out of the Great Recession, and yet we haven't addressed this issue successfully. We have those on the street who are struggling from mental health, and we don't have enough mental health services. We have folks who are wrestling with substance addiction and need assistance for that to change. And by the way, actually, I've talked to a number of folks who work with people on the street who have been able to get far more help than before because of the Affordable Care Act for those individuals wrestling with substance addiction. But we have just a whole lot of economic refugees who have come here, like those with vouchers and not been able to find a place, or just individuals who have a job, maybe it's a part-time job, maybe several part-time jobs, thought they would be able to rent an apartment and find that every place they go to has now, the rents have risen out of range of what they can do. Now, in addition to all those programs that are simply eliminated, there's programs that have been cut. And that includes HUD's rental assistance program, cut by $2 billion, and the housing choice vouchers that I've been referring to, cut by $300 million. So, we cannot accept this budget as a blueprint for where we go forward. I'm pleased that in the bill we just passed, referred to as the omnibus, which is a fancy way of saying a spending bill for many categories of government spending at the same time, that spending bill did not accept this blueprint for the final 5 months of fiscal year 17, which ended at the end of September. But the president's budget wasn't for fiscal year 17, it was for fiscal year 18. And that starts on October 1st. So between now and then, I'm going to be immersed in trying to make sure that these programs are not cut and these other programs are not eliminated. In fact, I'd like to see them enhanced. I'm serving on the Appropriations Committee, which is the spending bill committee. I lobbied very hard to get onto it because Oregon hasn't had anyone serve on this committee since Senator Hatfield retired. And since we don't have earmarks, the way that I can be helpful is to fight for the programs that are relevant to us back here in Oregon. And that's what I fully intend to do. So I just want to close by thanking the Alliance for recognizing that this is a significant issue and having a series of meetings on it, including the breakout sessions that are going to be happening later today. I think an economist is going to speak after I'm speaking, and then the breakout sessions. That's really excellent because this deserves a lot of attention by us all. And so thank you all very much for inviting me, and I think we have a few minutes to have questions if the moderator says that's okay.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm happy to ask. Well, I
figured. So I'm curious about what you think the prospects are for tax reform in the upcoming legislature, given how it's tied to housing.
So the question I'll repeat is, what do I think the prospects are for tax reform? And of course, tax reform can also affect housing. Senator Wyden is the ranking member of the Senate Tax Committee called the Finance Committee. And he has put forward a bill to significantly increase the tax credit program. Often when we've had difficulty forming a bipartisan alliance to fund a program, it has been easier to get a bipartisan alliance to essentially fund a program by offering tax credits. And so that's really why we have this program in the shape that it is, the federal tax credit program. So we're calling for a 50% increase in that program. There's bipartisan support for that particular provision. In terms of the broader question of will there be a massive tax reform bill, I do not think so. Now, since 1986, when Senator Packwood championed tax reform, there's never been a major tax overhaul. So we're talking more than 30 years now, which says how difficult it is to do that. The president did put out a one-page summary of what he wanted to do, and it said get rid of the estate tax, slice the capital gains, allow individuals to pass, high wealth individuals to pass through their income as if it was a company to, in order to get the capital gains rate rather than the standard income rate. You pile it all up, it amounts to, by best estimates, because we didn't have all the details, about a $6 trillion cost to the national treasury, with virtually all that money going to the richest Americans. Part of what we're seeing, and what, I mentioned this because it is relevant to housing, part of what we're seeing is that as inequality increases in America, you have more and more families that simply don't have the level of income, the living wage income, to be able to buy a house. And if they don't have the money to buy a house, then home builders are not going to build homes because they can't sell them. And so we're seeing a fair amount of high-end housing being built, and high-end condos, but starter houses, very few.
Do we have another question? Yes, sir.
Congress passes the budget. What sense do you have that there's Republican support for some of the housing programs you said were better on the?
I think there is a lot of bipartisan support for these housing programs. There were no voices that I heard from either side of the aisle saying, let's take the president's vision and start cutting these programs in the second half of fiscal year 17. And yet that would have been a perfect moment to start implementing that vision, had there been appetite for doing so. But you have cities that are struggling, families that are struggling on housing in every part of the country. This isn't a red or blue issue. This isn't an urban issue versus a rural issue. As I go about Oregon, going to every county every year, I meet before each of my town halls with the local elected officials, the county commissioners, the local elected city commissioners, and so on and so forth, the water district, whoever wants to come. And community after community in rural Oregon is struggling to have affordable housing. And many of them will say, we had interest from a company that thought about coming here because we have this asset or that asset, and then they found there would be no place for people to live because we don't have the housing stock. And they're asking for help with that. So I do think there's a solid bipartisan foundation for these programs.
Allison?
I was wondering if you could repeat how much of the budget was being cut for Section 8, project-based Section 8, and then how that cut would be implemented. Would it be a reduction of contracts nationally or non-renewal of existing contracts?
So there are a whole variety of different housing voucher programs. And I believe the category of housing choice vouchers program is the catch-all for that whole set. I will have to double check the details to make sure I'm right on that. But the budget has a $300 million cut to that category. I don't have the percent in front of me, but given the need, any cut is going to be significant. Oregon has roughly, I'm just speaking very crudely, 1% of the nation's population. So just translating that, again, in a very rough way, $300 million probably translates to at least a $3 million drop in what we'd have, a decrease in what we would have here in Oregon for the housing voucher program. And then the veterans vouchers are zeroed out.
Last question, Diane Lynn.
Diane, so good to see you.
Good to see you. Thank you so much for your amazing representation of the state of Oregon in Congress. Just to follow up on a couple of the other questions, the kind of money we're talking about, home, CDBG, SHOP, or at least home ownership in some of our, is such a decimal best amount of money in the big picture of the federal government's budget. And my question is two-part. Is that a compelling argument to your colleagues to say, aren't there other things, you know, you're going to make changes in the budget, is this really the place to go? A, and B, what can we do to help you make this case in Congress?
So I'll repeat the question for the coverage here, which is, aren't these programs taken together a very small percentage of the federal government? And shouldn't that help make the argument for making sure that they stay there? And second of all, what can all of you do to help me in this fight to keep these programs? Is that accurate way of putting it? Well, what the president's budget consisted of in the broad aspect was we want a $50 billion plus up in our military budget. And we are therefore going to slash and cut everything else on the domestic side. Now, this isn't simply, well, let's retaliate against cities because they voted on one side of the spectrum and help out rural America because they vote on the other. Not at all. Rural America is incredibly hit by these cuts. Rural contract tower support, supporting six rural airports in Oregon, rural transportation, rural water infrastructure. The list goes on and on. And by the way, rural America uses the CDBG and they use the home grants. Rural development is slashed, rural business services is slashed, etc. So back to your point about being this a modest share. The reason all these programs are cut was to fund this $50 billion increase on the military side. Now, just to share with you philosophically, I spent several years working for President Reagan's team on military policy, and then worked for Congress on military policy. And what I saw was an incredible number of programs that are funded because Congress wants to fund them, not because the military thinks that they contribute to our national security. So my belief is that there are a lot of things that we are doing on the national security side that aren't contributing to national security. Where we need to take those funds is invest them in the education of our children and the infrastructure of our nation, and that includes housing to make sure that we reach this mission statement of a decent home and a suitable living environment for every family in America. And what can you do? If you agree, please weigh in. Weigh in through your encouraging those you know on social media to weigh in with their House and Senate members. If you have a professional association or a hobby association, use that network to ask folks to weigh in, because it really has to be a grassroots set of voices. And in addition, it needs to be community leaders. And I know this room is full of community leaders. So for all of you to weigh in as community leaders and encouraging your leaders in other states and other districts to weigh in as well, that would be extremely helpful in these meetings to come. Thank you, Diane, and thank you for all your public service. Thank you all.
Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.